Welcome to Ring of Fire, I'm Farron Cousins. Tonight, we will be having more of our interviews from last week's Mass Torts Made Perfect conference, and we're very excited tonight because we have both Congressman Alan Grayson, who is currently running for the Senate seat being vacated by Marco Rubio in the state of Florida, and Abby Martin, the host of the Empire Files. Two great interviews coming up in just a few minutes. But before we get into that, I want to take a minute to talk about Ted Cruz. Now, at this point in the primaries, Ted Cruz would have to win slightly more than 100% of the remaining delegates in order to get the Republican nomination. Mathematically, physically, statistically, impossible at this point for Ted Cruz to get enough delegates to secure the nomination. But science, facts, math, statistics, those have not gotten in the way of Ted Cruz. They will not get him down. In fact, he is so confident that just yesterday he announced that Carly Fiorina is his choice for vice president should he get the nomination. Now, everyone looking at this, you don't have to be a political insider or analyst or have a degree in political science to understand why Ted Cruz picked Carly Fiorina. She is a woman, plain and simple. Now, why does that matter? Because the current GOP frontrunner, Donald Trump, has horrible polling numbers with women, both women and general, and self-identified Republican women. They hate the guy because he is a misogynist, he is rude, he's disrespectful, and he treats women like objects rather than human beings. So Ted Cruz pulls this little play thinking that he can just confuse the women in America into thinking that he is somehow on the side of feminism, that he believes in women's rights and that they're equal. And so he's picked Carly Fiorina. Now, obviously, Ted Cruz does not care about women. That's not a secret to anybody who's looked at his career. He doesn't want women to have a choice over what they do with their bodies. He doesn't think that they should have equal pay. He doesn't think that they should have equal rights. So Ted Cruz, when it comes to women, is just as bad as Donald Trump, if not worse, because at least Donald Trump hasn't tried to pass legislation that's going to take away women's rights. And if Ted Cruz wanted to try to fool the public into thinking that he was on the side of women, he sure as hell could have picked a better vice presidential choice among the many Republican women who serve in Congress or the Senate. Instead, he picked one of the most unpopular Republican women in the country. I think only Sarah Palin is less popular than Carly Fiorina. Now, this is a woman who did not win any primaries or caucuses, dropped out towards the beginning of the contests, had horrible performances during the debates, and that's just her political record, because that is the extent of political experience that she has ever had in her life. When you get into her corporate experience, she was forced out of her company because she was running it into the ground, forced to lay off tens of thousands of employees because she destroyed the company so bad and there was no money. In fact, her horrible business record, according to PolitiFact, is one of the only truthful things that Donald Trump pointed out during those early Republican debates. That was the only truthful thing he said, was when he talked about how horrible her record was. So Ted Cruz, in an attempt to make Donald Trump look bad, picked the only person whose attacks from Trump were honest. Cruz, give it up. You're not going to get the nomination. Your little deal with the devil with John Kasich is not going to keep Donald Trump from getting the nomination. As far to the right as you are, you've still lost the base that's even further to the right because they love Donald Trump. That is the problem with the Republican Party. And if you think that women are stupid enough to think that you're on their side just because you picked a female vice presidential candidate, then you've got some serious learning to do about the American public and how they feel and what they know. If you treat them like idiots, they're not going to vote for you. And now let's move in to tonight's interviews. Congressman Alan Grayson has been one of the most outspoken voices in the U.S. House of Representatives for years. And now he is running for a Senate seat in the state of Florida that hopefully he will win and bring some real change to the state. That is the seat that's currently held by no-show Rubio. And if Alan Grayson succeeds in his quest and ousts his Democratic opponent, who is more of a Republican than a Democrat, then we could really change the makeup of the Senate. So let's take a look at that interview. And following that interview, we'll be speaking with Abby Martin, host of the Empire Files, about just how dangerous Hillary Clinton will be if she becomes the next president of the United States, because she is the most hawkish candidate running for president today. Here at Mass Torts Made Perfect, sitting with Congressman Alan Grayson, we've always been a huge fan. Now you're running for Senate in Florida to take over the seat that Marco Rubio has vacated. He's actually vacated it long ago because he chooses to not go to work, something that most Americans really can't afford to do, but Marco Rubio's lucky enough that he can not go to work and still get paid.
That's why we call no-show Rubio.
Exactly. So I want to talk to you first about the campaign running for Senate. You do have another Democrat opponent, and your opponent seems to be a little bit more of the, should we say, Debbie Wasserman Schultz?
Oh, no, no, that's not fair to Debbie. He's a Democrat in name only. He gave $2,300 to Mitt Romney's campaign.
Oh, my goodness. That
he's got the fourth worst voting record of anyone, even who even pretends to be a Democrat in the House of Representatives. Let's not beleaguer Debbie with that label.
So I think your race in particular kind of highlights almost this growing divide within the Democratic Party, because we do have a lot of Democrats that seem to be a little bit further to the right. They're more open to accepting the corporate money and to writing it off.
You're being very kind. They're corporate shills. They're sellouts. They're people who, like the Republicans, cut the law into little pieces and then sell it off to the highest bidder. That's what we're talking about here. Let's not fancy it up. You can't put lipstick on that pig.
Well, you know, we're very thrilled, Florida residents, to have you running for Senate. We would love to see you in the Senate because you've done phenomenal work in the House of Representatives. I remember we had you on Ring of Fire radio many years ago, right after the vote on the Affordable Care Act, on which you were the very last signature. Mm-hmm. You made it a point to be the last to sign this piece of legislation before it went to the president. And so, talking about your work in the Senate, one of the things that's been most impressive is the fact that you're willing to stand up. You're willing to get out there and say what needs to be said, calling out the Bush administration on the Iraq War and Dick Cheney. And I think that is severely lacking in both the House and Senate at this moment.
Well, sure. I mean, basically, members of Congress have become cattle. They just do whatever they're told to do, and that's the end of the story. I don't see the job that way. I don't just talk the talk. I walk the walk. I've passed more amendments than any other member of Congress in the past 3 years, even though I belong to the minority party, and I lose on every party line vote. I've passed 54 amendments in the past 3 years alone. One opponent I have has passed 7. 2 other opponents have passed 0. And by the way, the average is actually 0. Most members of Congress have not passed a single amendment. I've passed 54. And these are good, solid, progressive amendments. I'll give you one example. Amendments that moved $60 million from the military weapons budget to the cancer research budget. I think that's really worthwhile.
That is, absolutely. And the military in the United States, obviously, we've seen numbers. We could cut it in half and we would still have the largest military in the world. And it seems odd, and we're allegedly in this time of peace. I know Republicans want to tell us that we're at war. We're at war with ISIS. But I have seen no formal declarations of war, and yet we're still sending, troops overseas. President Obama had said we were going to bring everybody home, and then they just escalated a month or two ago. These are things that the American public doesn't necessarily know about. I mean, they don't know that we just sent more American troops into the Middle East to fight this unwinnable war against an ideal, which is ISIS. I mean, ISIS is not necessarily the same as fighting a country or fighting a government. It is this unstructured group, really. And so with regards to foreign policy and Middle East intervention, what's your take on this?
Well, I try to bring home to people the ultimate price of this and how much of a damage it is to our economy and to taxpayers in general. There's actually two different war budgets. There's the conventional budget, which we call the so-called defense budget, which I consistently have voted against because, as you point out, it's enormously bloated, $500 billion a year. And then on top of that, there's another budget called the contingency budget, the overseas contingency budget, the OC budget. And that's money on top of what we give to the Defense Department to protect us in order to conduct these foreign military interventions one after another, often resulting in the killing of hundreds of innocent people through drone attacks, just to give you one example of the actual consequences here. As a result of these military interventions, in just a few years, we've gone from the most popular foreign country among the people of Pakistan, according to polling, to the least popular foreign country. Imagine what that does to our ability to sustain our positions in the world and our image in the world. I pointed out how much we're spending on this OC budget in a very interesting way. I introduced a bill called the War is Making You Poor Act. And I pointed out that if we simply required the Defense Department to sustain these overseas military interventions on the basis of the mere $500 billion that they get as part of their core budget, rather than this extra lanyap, then we could actually eliminate taxes on half of all Americans. Half of all Americans pay no federal income tax whatsoever if we simply made the Pentagon pay for its own wars.
And it is remarkable when we look at how much we're spending on these wars and just the military budget in general compared to what we're spending on U.S. citizens. We have too many people that live on the streets, too many people who, even though they have health insurance, are still going into bankruptcy because of medical bills. And we're doing almost nothing to help them. And a lot of it has to do with the fact that we have Republicans that tell us, if we cut the Pentagon's budget by even a dollar, you hate America. You want us to lose. You want us to lose this war to ISIS. The only war that's happening is the war of words from Republicans, the war of semantics. We need to bring that money back home. We need to help people. We need to fix problems like income inequality and pay inequality between men and women. And so you've spoken about this. So I want to get your take on that as well. You know, the income inequality issue. We've talked about the military budget. How do we address income inequality?
Well, you know, I have stirred things up a bit by pointing out that we have the fourth worst distribution of income and wealth in the entire world. PolitiFact was on the phone with my office within minutes of when I said that on the air in national TV and saying, that can't possibly be true. What's he talking about? And we provided them the information and they had to rate it true. They didn't want to rate it true because it's one of those inconvenient facts that plague our society. And if you look back, you'll find that the only standing ovation in the history of Bill Maher's show was when I was on the show and I pointed out that we've got 50 million people in America, 50 million people who can't see a doctor when they're sick. We've got 40 million people who rely upon the government to feed them. And this is unnecessary. There's no reason why we do things this way. We make the rules, we make the laws. There's no real good reason why a person who lives in Canada lives 2 years longer under a socialized medicine system with all that snow shoveling they have to do than Americans do on the average. There's no reason why the Japanese, with all the fogo in their diet, that's the poison fish they eat, they live 4 years longer than we do. And here's the worst statistic of all. Poor people in this country live 14 years less than rich people do. This is on the basis of a study that came out just last week. So the cost of being poor is not simply the grinding daily disaster called poverty. It's actually life stealing. It steals your life away. That's the greatest inequality of all, the inequality in how long you can live. And all this is completely unnecessary. You know, it doesn't have to be this way at all. I mean, we have enough money to make America an earthly paradise. Our per capita income, the amount of money, income for every man, woman, and child in this country is now over $50,000 a year. And yet, if you work for the minimum wage in this country, you make $14,000 a year working full time. So as Huey Long used to say, it's probably a good time right now to put a little bit of the jam on the bottom shelf where the little man can reach it.
And so with the influence that corporations have, with the fact that we have seen no prosecution for anyone on Wall Street for the corruption that led to the economic downturn, does this problem get addressed, or do we need this sea change? You know, this the progressive movement that is building nationally, is that what it's going to take to really change this system for the better so that it works for Main Street and not just Wall Street?
Oh, we badly need desperate change, and I think that more and more people come to recognize that. The only thing that actually is pushing against that is a sense that you can't change things. As I like to say, anomie is the real enemy. That's what's actually going on. Everybody agrees that things have to change, but some people get disheartened about the possibility of change. And that's terrible for politics in general. Politics is aspirational. You have to explain to people what you want to do, and then you have to go do it. There's 26 Grayson bills that are passed by the House, passed by the Senate, signed into law by the President. So when I go and I tell people I want to do these things, they understand that these are things that actually can get done. I've passed so many bills, so many amendments, in the face of enormous adversity with the Republicans in charge, the Tea Party Republicans in charge. But it's an absolute necessity. We have a disastrous inequality in this country, like no one's ever seen before, except at the very, very height of the 1929 boom/bust that ended up taking us right to the Great Depression. And in some respects, even beyond that, you know, more than 40 years ago, regarding the justice system, as you mentioned, at the so-called justice system. Bob Dylan had a beautiful song in 1973, I think. Part of the lyrics were, all the criminals in their coats and their ties are free to drink martinis and watch the sunrise. That's their justice system. It works for them. But as for everybody else, well, I mean, the system is so screwed up in my home state of Florida that 23% of all African American adults can't vote because they're convicted felons. 23%. Can you imagine how blue Florida would be if we didn't exclude those people from their own right to vote?
And it's very sad because that's by design. I mean, that is what the Republican Party wants because that's what the corporate bosses want. And it, as you pointed out, that doesn't change if you're just sitting home and being mad. Be mad, but get out there and be mad and do something and demand the change.
You know, I have to tell you, 125,000 people have been mad enough to come to our website and make a contribution to our campaign. I have the only Senate campaign in the entire country that's funded primarily by small donors who give less than $200. Our average campaign contribution is the Bernie Sanders proverbial $27 or a little bit less than that. And it works. I mean, we're going toe-to-toe with these enormous, powerful forces. Wall Street has donated more to my primary opponent, than any other Democrat in the House of Representatives. He is the number one recipient of Wall Street sewer money. And, basically at this point, it's literally Wall Street versus Main Street in our race. And I'm hoping that the people united can never be defeated. But it's glorious that 125,000 people come to our website, senatorwithguts.com. They're very modestly named. senatorwithguts.com, and they give whatever they can afford to give. And they understand they're not doing it for me, they're doing it for them, because we desperately need change in this country. And I'm one of the few people you can count on to actually deliver on that.
Congressman Alan Grayson, as a Florida resident, I hope that come next January, you are representing us in the Senate. Thank you very
much. Thank
you.
It'll be my honor. Thank you. I try not to blow it.
Sitting here, Master Horse Made Perfect, Abby Martin, wonderful to talk to you. Absolutely, real pleasure to have you here. And one of the things that you have covered extensively is foreign policy and the dangerous foreign policy of Hillary Clinton, really. And to me, that is one of the most underreported stories of this campaign, is the fact that we have Hillary Clinton, who essentially is the foreign policy of George W. Bush, except I feel like she's a little bit more aggressive than he was. So I want to get your opinion on this, because I find Hillary Clinton, in terms of foreign policy, to be one of the most dangerous people running for president right now.
Absolutely. When when she was a senator, no one really paid attention to her foreign policy, I think. As Secretary of State, it really was laid bare, fair, and it's just gotten so bad that you really look at every foreign policy endeavor when she was Secretary of State, and it's really her at the forefront pushing the most disastrous criminal policies, really overstepping Obama time and again. I mean, let's just go from the beginning. The drone program, she helped draft the drone program with Obama. Libya, it's called Hillary's War. I mean, untold misery, death, and destruction, where she's laughing about an African leader getting lynched on television, pioneering that disgusting endeavor. And where's the country now? It's a safe haven for a bastion for ISIS. And you know, when it comes to the Iraq War, she was not only voting for it, she was at the forefront of pushing for it unapologetically around the country, talking about how great it was, how we need to give Bush unequivocal, you know, just an unequivocal way to just go in there and do whatever he wanted. And it's just unbelievable when you look at this. Not only does she vacation with the Kissingers, you know, it's not just that she was getting foreign policy advice from him. She actually vacationed with that war criminal. So it wasn't just him and her giving quid pro quo about, oh yeah, you did a great job as Secretary of State. They're actually very close friends, which should scare anyone who knows anything about Kissinger. And then, you know, even when you go back to her as First Lady, it's really interesting because she actually pioneered a lot of things as First Lady. You know, she put herself out there, put her opinions out there, but she also pushed Bill Clinton to bomb Yugoslavia. There was a book that came out that talked about how she was praising herself for basically pushing Clinton into bombing, and you know, we know what happened there, just untold war crimes and pretty much the same thing that happened in Libya. So it's a complete disaster on all fronts. Her advisors are actually PNAC founder Robert Kagan, who was, you know, Project for New American Century. He is the peak of that, working with the worst neocons. And it's just amazing to look at every neocon in DC hates Trump, loves Hillary, endorses Hillary. What else do you need to know? All you need to know.
What's so fascinating about this is we have to go back to the corporate media.
Yeah.
If we had a media that was worth a damn in this country, we would know these things, but unfortunately, most people don't even know what PNAC is or was, or you know, they slightly disappeared and then reformed. But the media has failed so hard on this. And when you look at a network like MSNBC, it is now the Hillary Clinton network. Mm-hmm. They're not going to bring any of this up. Instead, they're going to bring on, you know, show Donald Trump's speech and then mock him for it. Rather than attack policy, it's just mocking. It's snark. It's not intelligent conversation. And that's missing because this is important information that we have to know about Hillary Clinton, who, according to polls and numbers right now, is looking like she could be the next president of the United States. Mm-hmm. And as dumb as Donald Trump may come across, I don't know that he's going to push us into wars like Hillary likely would.
Oh, I mean, when you look at everything she said, she's far to the right of every presidential candidate by far. Trump, you know, he's scary because he's so unpredictable, and I feel like he can get swayed kind of like Obama. He has, you know, like Obama had very little experience. Trump has zero experience. He can get in there and just be pulled by anyone saying, you need to do this, you need to do that. That's a scary thing about him. But Hillary, on the other hand, cold, calculated, heartless. You know, she's talking about super predators having no empathy. You have no empathy, Mrs. Clinton. I mean, look at everything you've done. I even forgot to talk about Iran. That is by far, I think, the scariest thing when it comes to a Hillary doctrine. She laid her flag in the Obama administration to show that she will take it farther above and beyond anyone would at that point, especially when it came to Iran. You have Robert Gates saying she was lobbying harder for the Afghanistan troop surge than anyone. She tried to keep troops in Iraq longer than Obama wanted to. And when it comes to Iran, she has tried to push for war, not only saying that she would obliterate the country if they tried to attack Israel, which is ridiculous because Israel is the one with nuclear weapons, but she also said, you know, time and again that she will not hesitate to use military action if they try to acquire WMDs. That's a great standard. We should trust you, right, Hillary, based on the Iraq war vote. So it's terrifying, Farron, and I really do think that she is, she would be the best CEO of the empire. The whole establishment is pushing for her to be in that position for very good reason. And when you're talking about the corporate media, it's you know, it's this conventional wisdom that we need to be an empire. That's never questioned. The militaristic, hawkish rhetoric of Hillary Clinton, And that's, you know, it's like, what's the point of having a woman as a president if you're just going to act like a militaristic hawk? Man, you know, I'd rather have someone who's more feminine bringing that side to foreign policy. So,
we know it's interesting. I spoke with Alan Grayson earlier, and he talked about the military budget and the fact that, you know, we're the largest military budget in the world. And even if we cut it in half, we're still the largest military budget in the world. You cut it by 75%, we're still the largest. And that has to stop. I mean, we can't be the world police. We can't be the George W. Bush, shoot first, never ask questions, you know, manipulate the media, manipulate Congress, manipulate the United Nations. This has to stop. I mean, America has become a parody of itself. Mm-hmm. And Hillary Clinton wants to take it further. Mm-hmm. I feel. I mean, some of my viewers may disagree with me. I'm sure a lot of people on YouTube are going to be angry, but this is the truth. I mean, you can look this up and you can see it, and you can see the Clinton Foundation, what they've done overseas in accepting money, you know, from the military contractors. It's scary. And Hillary Clinton, as president of the United States, if for nothing other than foreign policy, should terrify us.
Yeah, the Clinton Foundation's political bribery is quite astounding, because you realize, you know, not only did Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton kind of rise to and ascend to power based on this capturing of the right-wing conservative vote, actually, you know, the tough on crime, ending welfare as we know it. So that's kind of a contradictory thing with her whole position now, where she posits herself as the anti-Trump, you know, leftist candidate. So it's kind of funny when you look at her actual past. But going back to the Clinton Foundation, I mean, this is an organization that is multi-million dollar foundation that has done this kind of fake philanthropy work around the world to inject business, you know, micro-lending, and just to create kind of for-profit businesses in places like India and Latin America and Asia. So it's kind of just sketchy on the face of it. But then when you look a little bit further, you see who's actually funding it. It is absolutely shocking who is actually funding the Clinton Foundation. Gulf state monarchies, brutal theocracies, like literally Oman, the United Arab Emirates, Saudi Arabia. I mean, mind-blowing, right? And not only that, which is like, why are these criminal countries funding this like philanthropy network? And then you look at them lobbying the State Department when she was Secretary of State, getting giant, massive arms deals, and actually correlating to the amount of money that they were lobbying her and getting the biggest arms deal. So Saudi Arabia got the biggest one, and so on and so on down the line. And you look at, you know, the Viktor Pinchuk Foundation, this Ukrainian billionaire whose mission statement is to democratize Ukraine, lobbying the Secretary of State while the Ukrainian coup was going on. So every layer of that foundation, and it just goes, every bad criminal corporation that you could think of, Walmart, which he served on the board of directors for in the 80s to the early 90s, Chevron, I mean, every oil giant. And of course, we forgot about the banks, right, which is really the core of her whole political bribery machine.
Her being the front runner of the Democratic Party is insulting to the Democratic Party, just in the sense that everything for the last 8 years that we have spoken out against and said, this is bad, it's now acceptable because it's her. I mean, Joe Connison has been tweeting out saying, look, the money Hillary is receiving from banks and contractors, look, that's not a problem because you can't prove a quid pro quo. Well, hell, you can't prove a quid pro quo with Halliburton and Bush and Cheney, but that doesn't mean it wasn't there. That's what money in politics does. And Abby, thank you for your work, for staying on top of this. And I know you're going to continue to stay on top of this.
Yeah.
and more importantly, thank you for talking with us today. This is phenomenal. Keep up the great work.
Thank you so much, Baron. Thanks a lot for your work.